Hey there, it's Rachel Mullins, the host of Hashtag No Filter Fridays on Public House Media.
Strike three, you're out.
Welcome back to another edition of Caught Listening, the baseball show that goes beyond the white lines. Chris Heimall here with you, broadcasting as we do every single week on Public House Media. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts. That's Google or Apple Podcasts. You can also find us on Amazon Podcasts, Spotify, Spreaker.com, Stitcher.com, and of course, PublicHouseMedia.org. Encourage you guys to head on over to that website. Again, PublicHouseMedia.org. Check it out. Check out some of the other great shows as part of this wonderful network and get yourself some awesome Caught Listening gear. You got hats, hoodies, t-shirts, coffee mugs, whatever you're looking for. Head on over there. Check it out. We appreciate your guys' support. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, review. You can also share us with your friends and family on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Just search Caught Listening by Public House Media. You can also email the show, caughtlisteningphm@gmail.com. Be a part of the conversation. Let us know some of the stories you may want us to talk about. We are currently working on a number of series for 2021 that we are really, really excited about. Some things that folks have talked about. Women in baseball, the growth of and the acceptance of the Negro Leagues in Major League Baseball, the differences between independent, affiliated, how one baseball is going to look in 2021, the history of the Olympics, some of the biggest scandals that have happened in baseball, as well, and plenty, plenty more of that. If you have something you want us to talk about, by all means, let us know. This is going to be a little bit of a different show. Usually we bring somebody on and talk about one of those subjects that you guys have asked about, but this isn't necessarily a show where I'll give opinions or commentaries on certain things. I'll voice that through some interviews every now and again, but given what has happened this week and given our guest Brian Heimann last week regarding the Baseball Hall of Fame, this is a frustrating week as a baseball fan, to be honest. The fact that nobody gets voted in is, in my opinion, a travesty to the sport. You got to remember something. The Hall of Fame is a museum, first and foremost. It is about what happened over the history of this game. This is only, I believe, like the fourth time ever, or the fourth time in recent memory, that nobody is going to get voted in by the writers. Now, this is the first time since 1960 that nobody at all is going in from the class because the Veterans Committee, which usually meets at the winter meetings, did not meet this year, so they didn't vote anybody in. So, for the first time in 61 years, you are not going to have a single person inducted in a year as a class. There will be nobody, not even on the Veterans Committee, for the class of 2021. Now, because of COVID-19, because of the pandemic, the class of 2020 will get their due in Larry Walker and Derek Jeter. But here's my problem. The writers that have been around this game, and yes, they have seen more baseball than I have, but fortunately, Brian Heimann, who joined us last week, is not one of these writers. But there are many who feel as though they are the end-all, be-all. They are the high and mighty keepers of the gates to the Baseball Hall of Fame. And they find the worst, dumbest, most ridiculous excuses not to vote people in. There are writers who will vote who won't vote for anybody on the first ballot because they don't believe there should be anybody inducted on the first ballot. Now, Mo Rivera, Ken Griffey, Babe Ruth, there were people who literally did not vote for Babe Ruth to go into the Hall of Fame. There are people who believe that relief pitchers, exclusively relief pitchers, should never go in. Again, Mariano Rivera, the lone exception there, but Trevor Hoffman, Billy Wagner, Goose Gossage, John Smoltz, even though I know he was a starter and a reliever throughout his career. The game has evolved to a point where you need to include the most important people of these eras of baseball. To tell me that Curt Schilling does not deserve to be in the Hall of Fame, I don't care what Curt said. Listen, Curt Schilling, I don't care that he doesn't even consider himself a Hall of Famer. He doesn't vote. I don't care that he goes and puts out on Facebook that he wants to be removed from the ballot, and then the writers say the very, you know, a couple hours later, no, you're staying on the ballot. Writers say that, I guarantee you, just so they can stick it to him next year and not write him again. But what Kurt's problem has been, and has always been, since he retired, was not keeping his mouth shut. The problem is, that's after he stopped playing. The Hall of Fame is meant to be for the contributions to the game of baseball. And Curt Schilling is a Hall of Famer by those standards. Does he have a tremendous win total? No, only 216. Does he have a great ERA? Not by what most, let me just say it, old writers would think. 346. It's still better than some of the guys who are currently in the Hall of Fame. But when you consider the length of his time, 20 years, when you consider, if you care about this stuff, his WAR, wins above replacement, 79.5. Pretty freaking good for a pitcher, especially who pitched in the era in which he did, in the height of the steroid era, playing against some of the most inflated hitters of all time, and competing the way he did, especially in the postseason. Curt Schilling in the postseason was one of the most dominant pitchers ever. A three-time World Series champion, a World Series MVP in 2001 with the Diamondbacks, an NLCS MVP as well in 2001. You look at him in the postseason and what he did in his career, 11-2 with a 2.23 ERA and a whip below one. He was at his best when it mattered most, winning three World Series championships, one in Arizona, two in Boston, of course, the 2004 bloody sock game in the ALCS, which we will all remember. You cannot tell me that a person like that, who has had that much impact on a game, on the field, does not deserve to be in. Now, one of the issues with this, same issues with a number of other players who haven't gotten in. The writers don't like him. He wasn't a good soundbite. He wasn't a good interview. He wasn't great. Boo freaking who? The problem with so many writers and media members is that they, and I'm going to say this as someone who has worked in the media for a long time and has been around major leaguers and has been around NFL legends and NBA legends. Most of writers, at least most of the older generation of writers, are disgruntled former has-beens, never could-have-beens. They're upset that they never got the chance to be big leaguers. They're never upset. They're upset that they weren't good enough for the most part. Now, again, I know I'm speaking in generalizations here, but it is embarrassing to me that a group of people, just because a guy wasn't nice to you, just because he wasn't a great soundbite, means you're going to completely take away what he has done to this game and leave him out of the Hall of Fame. Curt Schilling will go into the Hall of Fame from the Veterans Committee. Why? Because it's a group of players. Players who believe he is a Hall of Famer. Let's get to Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens. You cannot ignore the steroid era in baseball. Because guess what? We all did. We all ignored it. We all lavished in it. We all soaked up the rays of sunshine that were brought down on baseball by the steroid era. And to now, all of a sudden, keep guys out. When you as a media member, as a writer, were standing in the locker room and could see whatever it was going into someone's body, and you didn't say anything then. Now you're going to try to say something? That is incredibly hypocritical of you. One of my most favorite people from a sportscaster standpoint, from a sports media personality, is Dan Patrick. Dan Patrick has told this story multiple times on his national show, that he saw a bottle of Andro in Mark McGwire's locker room. He didn't say anything. He's even admitted that he should have done more. The owner should have done more. The managers, the players, the fans, the media should have done more. You can't go back and rewrite history. Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens, I don't care that they were Hall of Famers before they took whenever we think they were. They're Hall of Famers now. Because the Baseball Hall of Fame is a museum. And they deserve to acknowledge what has happened. If Major League Baseball's record books can list Barry Bonds as the all-time home run king and the single-season home run king, the Baseball Museum and Hall of Fame can get off its high horse and put him in the Hall of Fame. Roger Clemens is one of the very few to throw a 20-strikeout game, one of the very few left to have 300 wins, not to mention a 3.12 ERA. not to mention a WAR, if you care about this stuff, of 139.2. He deserves to be in the Hall of Fame. In 2022, when Alex Rodriguez and David Ortiz are on the Hall of Fame ballot for the very first year, they deserve to go into the Hall of Fame. Say what you will about A-Rod. The guy was suspended for an entire year. He was an absolute jerk to a lot of people. A lot of people in the media. And he has been on this crazy campaign. He borderline ruined baseball for 2 years with his whole defamation lawsuit and all of that nonsense that he went through. But the numbers he put up, he is a Hall of Famer. Because he was part of this era. Pudge Rodriguez, suspected. Mike Piazza, suspected. They deserve to be in the Hall of Fame. Because of the numbers they put up and the impact they had on this game. Barry Bonds, Roger Clemens, Curt Schilling are surefire, no doubt, Hall of Famers. Because it is a museum and because of the era in which they played, where it is widely considered that everybody was a part of the steroid era. Kurtz has nothing to do with steroids. It has everything to do with the fact that people don't like his personality. Boo freaking who? O.J. Simpson is still in the Football Hall of Fame. And if you got a problem with Curt Schilling spouting his mouth off, but not a problem with O.J. Simpson, we got bigger issues to deal with. And that's what you need to be figuring out. Those three deserve to be in the Hall of Fame. Next year, A-Rod, as well as Poppy, deserve to go in the Hall of Fame. First ballot in my mind, too. Because for a point there, Alex Rodriguez was not only the best shortstop in the league, he was the best player in the league for about a 5-6 year span. David Ortiz revolutionized what it meant to be a power hitter at the DH spot. He did. The longevity. And everybody loves him, too. And Ortiz might get in simply because everybody loves him. He's an incredibly likable guy. It's going to be an interesting vote to watch in 2022. Between A-Rod and Ortiz, because A-Rod was a jerk to everybody. He's gotten better the last 5 years with his campaigns and all the stuff that he's been doing national, trying to buy the Mets, being on national TV as a broadcaster. But Ortiz, very few people could say a bad word about Ortiz other than the steroid thing, which should not be overlooked. I understand that. But again, you cannot ignore the era of this game. You cannot ignore the impact of these games. If you're going to put Barry Bonds' bat from when he hit number 755 or number 71, but not the actual guy in? That doesn't make sense. Baseball cannot benefit from the history made by these players and not include them in the history of the game. They cannot do that. And the writers need to get their heads out of their tails and understand that. I will say this, I was happy to see guys like Scott Rolen and Omar Vizquel make big jumps. Scott Rolen to me is one of the best defensive third basemen of all time. Omar Vizquel is one of the best defensive players ever. Ever. But again, you know, Vizquel more at the tail end of his career, but Rolen played a lot in an era where you needed offense. You know, you need to put up sexy numbers. I tell you what, Rolen still did that. 281 lifetime hitter, 316 home runs. He was pretty good. Omar Vizquel, 400 stolen bases, a 272 lifetime average, and a phenomenal defensive player. Phenomenal defensive player. By any metric, those two are Hall of Famers. They are. Defensively, when you look at comparatively, too, some of the other guys that are in. They're Hall of Famers. Billy Wagner's another one that kind of bothers me that he doesn't get in. On his sixth year in the ballot. A whip under one. An ERA of 2.3 and 422 saves. Now, I get it. He didn't play for a lot of great teams. But he was a relief pitcher of the year. And he is arguably the most dominant left-handed relief pitcher of all time. This is a guy who finished sixth in the Cy Young Award in 2006. Fourth in 1999. When he also finished 16th in the MVP race. by all metrics, Billy Wagner is a Hall of Famer. But again, because he's a relief pitcher, or because he, I don't know, is left-handed, or he didn't play on great teams. He only made the postseason 7 times. And, you know, 14 games didn't allow a single hit in 14 appearances in the postseason. Not his problem. His team didn't put up runs. He was there. He gave them every single chance they had. When you look at his stuff comparatively, he's right in there as a likely Hall of Famer from a pitching standpoint. He's right there. But it's going to be interesting to see what happens because, again, you know, there are people who don't want to put in relief pitchers, people who don't want to put in closers. But for a period of time, for a good 7, 8, 10 years, he was the most dominant left-handed relief pitcher in the game. And when you dominate the game for that long, you deserve to be a part of the Hall of Fame. I don't know when this started, but we started getting this argument about it's the Hall of Fame, not the Hall of Very Good. Well, the problem with that is, if you really start scrutinizing, where do you put what deems Hall of Fame worthiness now? And this is where it's all subjective, and I get it. Contributions to the game, but and the writers are asked to also include their integrity, their character, all that stuff. But I'm sorry. The Hall of Fame is about the greatest players to have ever played the game. Whether you liked them or not, whether they would sign an autograph for a kid, whether they would take extra time out of their day to talk to you as a reporter, that shouldn't matter. What matters is what did they do between the white lines? When they put the uniform on and they stepped across the foul line, were they one of the greatest players of their generation or of the game? Regardless of what happened. Because, and I'll say this about steroids, I don't care how many steroids you take. You still got to hit the damn ball. You still got to locate your pitches. And to do it for as long as guys like Bonds and A-Rod and Clemens and Ortiz and pick whoever, there's something to be said for that. Just because you didn't like them, just because you don't like how they went about it, doesn't mean a damn thing. This is the history of the game of baseball. And if you, again, I've said it before, if you are going to try to benefit from the history of these players that they've made, but not include them in the history of the game, it makes no sense. How many times does Major League Baseball even put out highlights of Pete Rose chugging into home plate in an All-Star game? Charlie Hustle. How much money does Major League Baseball make off of people who buy tickets to Reds games that wear Rose jerseys? How much money does Major League Baseball make off the All-Star game of Reds fans who were there, or let's say even now, Giants fans, Yankees fans, Red Sox fans wearing Bonds and Clemens stuff at All-Star games, at other venues? Major League Baseball profits off the history made by these players, but doesn't want to include them in the history of the sport. It makes no sense. And it is wrong of the writers. It is disingenuous of the writers to try to do that. And that's what bothers me the most about all of this. You can't tell me that those type of people don't deserve to be in the Hall of Fame. You can't. You can't tell me that. I don't care that they use steroids. I don't care that they're a jerk. I don't care that they don't have the right political affiliations in your mind. I certainly don't agree with a lot of stuff Curt Schilling has said. And I really wish he would just shut the hell up. But he's a Hall of Famer. Babe Ruth smoked so many cigars, drank so many beers a day. By all accounts, was a womanizer. You can't tell me that that doesn't deserve inclusion in the Hall of Fame. Or, you know, you can't judge that against him because he was one of the greatest players ever. May not have been a good person, tremendous player. And that's all that matters. It's the Baseball Hall of Fame, not the Life Hall of Fame. That's what the writers got to get figured out. Appreciate you guys listening. Appreciate you tuning in. Looking forward to chatting with you more next week. I'm Christian Heimall. You've been caught listening.